Now, when it comes to wrapping, let's see. So you guys know the sterile techniques? Do you want me to go over it? To hear a hallelujah. So wherever your environment is, you need to get ready and set up, right? So pretend I have gloves. I'm not gonna use gloves, but pretend I have gloves, right? So if you wanna set up, you know somebody's coming and you wanna set them up, you wanna make sure that your stuff is ready to go. My gloves are in place. I've got my my gauze, so you have to estimate. And then I usually carry, I think this is 3-inch elastomere. I carry 2-inch elastomere, and then of course I carry the 1-inch elastomere. Elastomere is a little bit, where's my 2-inch? That's 3-inch. Oh, here's my, it's my 2-inch, and then my 1-inch. So my 1-inch, I usually use it for fingers, right? And then this one I'll use for a little bit bigger, like finger and hand. And then anything in the wrist or elbow, I'll use this. And then we have non-sterile 4x4 with non-sterile 2x2s. And then of course I have sterile ones as well. So I'll grab what I need based on what I think I need, and I'll set my station up ready to go. Because once I put my gloves on, I don't want to touch anything else outside of this, right? So if I think I need a suture removal kit, I'll get it ready, right? I'll just get it ready and I'll have it on here. And I have usually my normal saline bottle. And I always make sure I have a little bit of tape. I usually use paper tape, but just right now I got transport tape. It really doesn't matter. So I'm gonna get my space ready. If I know I need normal saline, this is a brand new bottle of normal saline. I'm gonna open it. Oh, it's not, no. I will take the tab off, right? I'll take the little tab off so that it's ready for me, right? And I'll put my bottle on the table and I'll put the cap on the sterile field. I'm gonna try to keep, so this is not like sterile like in a hospital sterile, in the OR sterile, because in that sense, you have very specific way, another specific way of doing it, and everything is sterile. And the way they open it and they dump the sterile stuff onto the sterile field, and then you don't touch anything until you do the sterile glove technique. But that's beyond the scope of, you know, like doing something in the clinic. You're just trying to emulate as much of the sterileness as you can, by getting yourself ready, because once you start touching your patients, you can't go touching everything else with your dirty gloves, right? I know I might say it as like, you're like, oh my God, I already know this, but you'd be surprised at like what people forget, because we have a tendency to forget what we've touched, right? So get your stuff ready, and then you have your hand, and then I'll give you some tips on what I do for wrapping. Right? So, if I'm cleaning, right, I'll get my 4x4, or if I have a smaller piece, I'll scrunch it up, right? I'll scrunch it up and I'll take the normal saline and I'll pour it into my hands. Now, mind you, I have gloves on. Just pretend I have gloves on. I just don't want to put them on. And then I'll just gently squeeze to distribute the normal saline. And then I'll open it up and then I'll clean their hand or whatever, right? And then once I've done that, I just throw it away. If I need more, I'll just grab and I'll pour it. At no point do you ever want to take a 4x4 and touch it to the lip of the normal saline and then pour it into it. Because once you touch the lip, it's contaminated. It's no longer sterile. All right, so you're trying to keep it as sterile as possible. Another way to keep this real sterile is if you know you're taking someone's sutures out, you'll open it and have it be ready, right? This was for a patient earlier today, right? So I'm gonna just take it out if I take all this stuff out, as long as I don't touch this tray, everything in this tray is sterile. So then I'm gonna pour my normal saline in here. And then I'm gonna work off this tray as if this is sterile. So now I can dip in there, because once I use this, I'm gonna throw all of this away. Because I'm doing this, I'm gonna throw it all away, right? So I'm just gonna use however, clean it, and then dispose my gauze to the side, right? So that's how, if I wanted to, I really wanted to get a certain amount of normal saline into a container, I can use a container of my suture removal kit, right? So once I clean it and everything like that, and I wanna wrap it, this is zero form. So there's a little piece left, right? So this is zero form. And what you wanna do is you wanna use the sterile scissors to cut the size piece that you need, right? So we had the guy that had all this, and all you would do is you would lay it down on all of his, wherever you think he needed it. So if you have a bigger wound, you would leave it full, right? But if you had a smaller wound, you would cut it based on your size. The thing is like you don't want to over masticate an area. So if you only need it on a small section, then you want to cut it down to cover only the small section, right? Let's say it's a deeper wound, you just want to cover that section. But if you cover everything, they're going to come out, their skin's going to be all macerated, right? So just be careful. That's why I usually cut it. Does it have to be exact? It does not have to be exact, right? So once you use this, it's all done, right? So you cover the wounds, you go to wrap a patient, right? The easiest way to start to wrap is always the roll needs to be on the outer side. If you roll and you roll with the roll on the inner side, it actually makes it really hard for you to roll, and you could potentially drop it, right? If you put it so that you're rolling to the outside, it's a lot smoother. So let's say, for example, my guy has incisions here and on his fingers. You always have to think, how do I anchor this down? If you just wrap somebody around and around like this, it's not anchored and it's covering their fingers, right? So you have to, in your mind, there's no right or wrong, right? There's no right or wrong. Only thing is that there's a certain amount of anchor, and you wanna go in between fingers if you can, right? So you're gonna, and this Elastimmune, or the another brand, I think it's called Conform. We used to use Conform a lot. But basically it has a stretchy component. Look at its stretchiness, right? The stretchiness is good, but just like anything that's really stretchy, it can be very constrictive, just like Coban. So you have to be careful with the amount of pull and tension you're putting to it. So let's say you're gonna go wrap around. So I'm gonna put a certain amount of layer down, right? I'm gonna roll it, right? And I wanna go in between the fingers, right? If I wanna go in between the fingers, I can just pull it through, right? Once I pull it through, to ensure that it's not so tight, I'm gonna pull it out from here. It's got a certain amount of stretchiness. So at no point do you wanna do anything where it's constricting your MPs and holding it so tight at the bottom that the fingers get swollen. So that's one of the things that I do. I'll put it in between, like, you know, you get those fat fingers that they're so swollen, they're like sausages. And so you wanna make sure that you do a little pull out here so it's not so tight. Then you can come down around, you know, and you can even anchor down the wrist, crisscross through up here, and then you go between the fingers. Again, if you're going between the fingers here, you wanna make sure you just give it a little pull so that it's not so tight, right? And then you can go around, and it can be around the wrist, or it could be like here at the palmar section, right? If let's go in between the thumb, and then you can go in between the fingers here. Let's say you're trying to do that. let's say you needed to wrap around the fingers a little bit because his fingers were, he had the incisions on his finger. It's essentially the same thing. You'd come up here and you could wrap around the fingers, right? So why am I gonna use this continuously? Right, so I'm gonna wrap around the fingers, right? And I come down, I'm gonna keep it loose, right? And then I can come, see how that just rolled off? That was a terrible example. And come around, so I'm gonna hold it down here. I'm gonna go in between the fingers, right? And then I'm gonna wrap around the fingers like that. Now you're gonna have to fix it a little bit, you know, to straighten it out so that it doesn't have a lot of creases, right? So you can go like this, right? And then so on and so forth, right? So that's one way of doing it, so that you're doing the hand and the fingers. And the reason why I do the hand and the fingers all at the same time, I just want to make sure the thing that you're paying attention to is, can they make a fist? When they make a fist, is it too constrictive, right? But I do that so that, one, everything is anchored down, but two, it's time efficient. So you know what it is like. I mean, even if you have a patient one at a time, the amount of time it takes to do wound care, to clean, to wrap, and to still move them, it's a lot of stuff to do. God forbid you have to make a splint on the sit as well, you know? Like, so you have to plan out your visit. What am I gonna do? And what am I gonna do today? Because I'm gonna see this dude again tomorrow. But I wanna be as efficient with my time as possible, right? So so that's one of the reasons why it's efficiency, that I wrap one string versus going around each finger. Now, if it was just one finger, it doesn't matter, right? If you have one finger, let's say I use this, I can start at the top and I could wrap around, right? Wrap around. And if I wanted to, I can come around the hand, right? And then I could go to the next finger, right? And go to the next finger. So sometimes you're just playing around, but you see what happens here is it starts to slide out, right? So then you can come around, you'd have to anchor it down, and then you could go around the other fingers, right? And then you'd end it. But there's no, you have to do it this way, you know? The key things that you just have to think about is, you know, is it covering what I need it to cover? Is it covering, because all gauze is to keep the incision dry and to soak up any bleeding, right? So you have to ask yourself, is it covering what it needs to cover? And then you need to ask yourself, is it going to stay? Right? It doesn't help if you put something in and it's sliding off and it's sliding, you know, if patient comes in and they're like, oh, it just slipped off. Well, one, it's too loose, or two, it's not anchored. So is it doing what it's supposed to do? Is it covering what I need to cover? Is it gonna stay on, right? And then you have to ask yourself, just like when you're splinting, where are my potential problems that I'm gonna run into, or they're gonna run into, right? Is it too tight? Is it cutting off circulation? Is it stopping him or her from moving the way that they're supposed to move, right? So if you need them to move, then the dressing's gotta not constrict them from moving, right? Doesn't matter that they can't move all the way. Is it stopping them? What if by tomorrow they can move, but they can't because of the dressing? So you always have to check on that tension. And it's really about tension, and it's not about bulkiness. In some dressings, you have to put more bulky, right? So that is wrapping.
Hey therapy friends, it's Hwang here. Thanks again for watching my video. And if you like videos like this that can help you just crush it in the hand therapy world as an occupational therapist, then hit the subscribe button and enjoy the video. Thanks again for watching.